tell everyone I know, so I can be free. I can be whole. I can tell everyone I know. Jesus, hallelujah. So I can hoop and holler. I know how to do that. I'm trained how to do that. I've watched it for years. I'm a very good vet. You know, I can do voices and all that. But here's the thing. God is calling us to this moment because there's some walls that need to come down.
Yeah.
And I'm going to try to get through this, okay? But I got to tell you the face that I kept seeing all day while I was praying. One, I saw you all day. You were with me all day. I've been carrying you with me since last night, right? And I'm going to tell you why. Because what I don't know, don't need to know. I care, but I don't care. I care what you're going through, but I don't care about the details. You understand? Right? So I need you to understand. I've been carrying you with me all day because what you've been going through exemplifies exactly why God called me to do this. And God didn't call me to do this because I could have stayed. I got my phone coming all the way from out here from Far Rockaway, Brother Bird. I could have stayed in my church and did this, but the Lord told me to come here to do this, right? And the reason why the Lord told me to come here to do this is because you need to be here. All of y'all need to be here. All my family from back in the day need to be here. Jason, you needed to be here, right? And Mommy Yvonne, you needed to be here, right? And it needed to be this convergence of people,
right,
to do this, to kick this thing off of what God is trying to do. Here's what God is trying to do. God is trying to get past the tradition,
yes, sir,
of what we do,
yes,
into the efficacy, yes, of what needs to be done.
Amen.
I'm going to say that again. God needs to get past the tradition that you need to see. Because what a lot of us who've been in church a long time don't understand is that most people don't have a God problem. They have a church folk problem.
Amen. Praise God.
Woo! If you don't have... I talk to kids every day. I work in a college camp. I talk to kids every day. I talk to gay kids. I talk to straight kids. I talk to black kids. I talk to Latino kids. I talk to Muslim kids. I talk to Christian kids. And none of them have a God problem, but most of them have a church folk problem. Come on, help me say that. So let me explain something to you. Part of the wall that needs to be torn down is the wall that's torn down that makes people uncomfortable shedding themselves in church. And that leads to, see, and this is exactly why you came here. See, God makes absolutely no mistakes, right? Because when, it's just something, when, you know, when Minister Drell told me, so I want his brother Andre Bird, I'm like, I don't know Andre Bird, who is he? I seen his face around, but okay. But then the Lord said, shut up and say yes. So I shut up and I said yes. And exactly what you said is exactly why we need to do this. Because there's young men and young women serving in our churches. Serving in our churches.
Amen.
Sunday after Sunday, they come and they praise dance, they come and they sing, they come and they play on the organ, they come and they do things in the church, but nobody is hearing their pain, and they're in pain. And they're in pain because the church is not listening. And the church, because the church is so caught up in perpetuating itself that the church is not perpetuating healing. It is people are coming to church broken and leaving one broken. At this point in my life, I'm on a coast. I want to get on my skateboard and I just want to coast. I got about 20 more good years and I just want to coast. I just want to chill. I just want to sit back. I want to get up and I want to preach on every Sunday morning. I want nobody to bother me. And I just want to preach and I want to lay hands on the sick and I want them to recover. And I want to bless the babies and I want to bury the dead and I want to marry in love. And I don't want to, part of me doesn't want, but part of me has to fight.
Amen.
Because when God says to you that you're called to a moment like this, then you either either answer the call or you reap the whirlwind. And the whirlwind is being reaped is watching people die in front of your face. And I'm not talking about dying going into the grave. I'm talking about looking out into the eyes of the people in the church, and they're looking at you waiting for something to happen, and nothing's happening, and it's not God, it's the people that are holding back the move of God. And I'm not talking about dead churches. I'm not talking about the dead churches where folk come in and they just they sing the old meter hymns, and you know I'm talking about they got all of that going on. They got you know the James Fortune going on in church, and they got the Kirk Franklin going on in church, and the Tasha Cobb going on in church, and folks is shouting and speaking in tongues and falling out, but nobody is being delivered.
That's right. Yes.
And they got good shopping sets.
Right.
Yeah. Choreographed like Dancing with the Stars.
Yes.
But nobody's being delivered.
Come on now.
Huh? The musicians are professional and precise.
Right.
Huh? And they can, man, listen, they play them 16ths and them 30 seconds. They got, and everybody stops at once. And everybody sings on cue. And everybody's a key. But nobody's being delivered. First wall is the wall of tradition.
Yeah.
And once we get past the wall of tradition, all right, I know somebody gonna say, oh, but he ain't said nothing about the word. But let me help you. I'm gonna give you a recap, and then we're gonna do exactly what God said to do. Right? Because last night we talked about the six times that they went around Jericho in silence, right? And I said, real G's move in silence. Right? Yes. And the reason why real G's move in silence is because we're not talking about gangsters, we're talking about greatness.
Yeah.
And the reason why greatness moves in silence is because greatness doesn't have time to look at its past. Yeah. Greatness doesn't have time to hear what people are saying about it. Yeah. Greatness only contemplates its next move towards further greatness. Somebody say hallelujah. But they went around six times for 6 days. And the seventh day, they went around seven times. Now, first thing I need to tell you that is a consequence tonight is that the reason, and this is all Joshua chapter 6. Go back and read it for yourself. It's all on your phone. I ain't got to read to you. This ain't nursery school. So I don't need to read to you. But listen, we're around six times on the seventh day. First of all, you need to understand numbers have importance. There's a whole book of numbers in the Bible for a reason, right? And because we black people, because we used to play the numbers, we used to hit the bow leader.
Remember
the number home on 225th Street? You know, my mama told me go down here, go down and put in 999 for $1. I said, Mom, you can't accommodate 999. You ain't supposed to accommodate it because I'm waiting for 999 to come out. And then one day she didn't have $1, 999 came out. And she said, why did you have $1? Put 999 in it because we play numbers. Right? When Richard Pryor said, book the numbers, don't need paper, put no pencil. But numbers are important. And I'm not talking about, and then what they did was they took the numbers from us and put it on Channel 7 with Yolanda Vega.
Yeah.
But numbers are important. When the number 3, the number of the Trinity, is important. Right? The number 40, 49, 50, the number 7 is of great significance. It's God's number. God created the world in 7 days. I can give you all the spiritual significance, but I need you to understand it is significant because six times going around was not enough. It was the seventh time, it was the completion. It was completion of them being obedient to what God had told them. What you have to understand is, again, I'll say to you that what God told them seemed unlikely and frankly seemed kind of crazy, kind of stupid. Right? We don't have a military plan. We don't have no swords. We don't have no horses. He's telling us to go around with priests with trumpets and we're supposed to blow horns. And on the seventh day, then Joshua said, I'll tell you when to make some noise. So we're supposed to make some noise, and that's supposed to bring this wall down. You got to understand, they were looking at the wall that was built with brick. Go Google it. Google the Jericho wall. It will show you the wall, right? So any wall, I don't care how unsubstantial it is. I don't care if it's made of sheetrock. I don't care if it's made of bricks. But any wall needs that any watch from HGTV like I do, you know that in order to bring a wall down, we need some force.
Right. Yeah.
Am I correct? Yeah. You need the people take sledgehammers and all that stuff, and they have force to bring down a wall. But he's telling them then I'm going to bring down this wall. Then I'm going to bring you down this wall. I'm going to bring down this wall, and I'm going to give you everything on the other side of the wall. So they circled 6 days in silence, because they was real genius. And it's the 7th day they circled 6 times. And after they circled 6 times, Joshua, in obedience to God, said, shout, because God has given you the city.
Yes.
So I'm going to hang my hat tonight. God has given you the city. Let me explain to you what I'm saying to you. See, they had no idea what was in the city. They had kind of an idea because they sent Rahab and they reconnoitered, but they hadn't seen the city for themselves. So there was no vision. All they saw was a wall. They could have, the wall could have came down and it could have been like a campus on the other side, right? But in faith, they knew that something that God had promised them was on the other side. That's the first point we have to have. That on the other side of what you're going through, there's a promise from God for you. I'm going to help somebody tonight. There's a promise of God for you because God has something that he wants to give you that seems impossible. It seems at best unlikely. It seems like this doesn't really make any sense. But I can guarantee you that if you just would be obedient to what God is saying, it seems unlikely that God will give you the spectacular. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
The second thing I need you to understand is that there is something that you must do in order to facilitate the walls to come tumbling down. So we can talk about physical walls, right? We can talk about physical, but let's talk about walls of faith. Huh? Is anybody got any walls that's blocking you? Some of us are on our jobs, we've been working on our jobs for years, and we try to get that last promotion to get us where we want to be before retirement, and it seems like there's a wall there blocking you from getting you. Am I right about it? Some of us have been in failed relationship after failed relationship, and it seems like you find somebody, you get with somebody, you spend some time with somebody, they seem good, but it seems like you get to a certain point in the relationship, and am I talking to anybody in here? It just seems that things just don't go right. It seems like just as soon as you start to stack your money a certain way, and you get just enough to do what you got to do, that something comes to suck all of the life out of all of your savings, and you got to square one again. Sounds familiar to anybody? These are all walls. Let me help you. Let's go from the micro to the macro. We need to understand there's a black people in this country. There have been walls that have been erected for us before we was even a thought. Help me, somebody.
Yeah.
You need to understand that what we're going through today, when we start hearing cold words from people like Donald Trump about making America great again, I just need somebody to tell me when America was ever great for us.
Amen.
Help me, somebody in here. When was America ever great for us? When did a black man or a black woman ever get a fair shake in the States of America? When did the flag ever wave for us? Help me, somebody. When did we ever experience the land of the free and the home of the brave? Somebody help me. Somebody tell me that they hit that third stanza of the national anthem for us for years, where it talks about there's no respite for the hiring or the slave. And they had us singing this song with our hands over our heart while we going out dying for a country and they gonna die for us. How many of us understand what Muhammad Ali was saying was when he said, "You my poser, but you the one to keep me from freedom. I ain't got no beef with no Viet Cong over there." See, you gotta understand. I know some of y'all say, well, what is he talking about? I'm talking about the things. These are the things that God wants us to see, because we're supposed to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. And a lot of us walk around with our head in the sand, and we think that social justice has nothing to do with what we're doing in church. But what I'm telling you is that social justice has everything to do with what we're doing in the church. I need you to understand that Jesus was a liberator. I need you to understand that Jesus was a radical. I need you to understand that the reason why they wanted to kill him wasn't because he was the spiritual leader of the new Christian movement. They wanted to kill him because he was speaking truth to political power. I need you to understand that every movement that meant anything to a black man or black woman in this country started in the black church. And when we allow the black church to become co-opted.
That's right.
Talk about it.
When we sell the black church out.
That's right. Talk about it.
When we allow the black church to become more involved with an offering. Then we are with a movement.
Uh-huh.
When the black, we got black churches that refuse to say black lives matter.
Yes.
It's war. 2016 not giving women a fair shake in the church or in society.
Right.
It's the walls that need to come tumbling down.
Right.
When some of y'all still, from when we was kids, when I was the one saying, yo, won't you smile, baby? And now it's 35 years later, and Negroes half your age, won't you, oh, you smile, baby? Negro, because I don't like you. Huh? There's still some walls that need to come tumbling down. We're still doing the same thing. We're still some of the dudes that I used to hang out with. I'm 52 years old. And some of the same dudes that I was hanging out with back in 1985 was hanging in the same weak clubs, drinking the same weak liquor, chasing after the same weak people today, chasing after. Back in 1985, we need to break down some walls. Am I right about it? Personal walls.
Yes, God.